Yakitomi. Voice of the Web. The Grinning Mummy. By C. Brequin. A Jules de Grandin story, produced by Roland Wiefring from the Netherlands. Chapter 1. Is that you, de Grandin? I called, as the front door's slam was followed by the sound of quick footsteps on the polished boards of the hall floor. No. An irate voice responded as my friend, Professor Frank Butterbough, strode into my study. Apologize for coming in without knocking, Trowbridge, he offered an excuse, but I'm too confounded mad to pay attention to the amenities right now. Look at this, will you? Look at this damn impertinent, he broke off, choking with color, and gave the paper another bellicose flourish. Of all the unqualified, unmitigated. What is it? I queried, reaching for the offending document. What is it? He echoed. It's an outrage, a disgraceful outrage, that's what it is. Listen to this. Snatching at the white black ribbon looped about his neck, he dragged a pair of gold and tortoiseshell pine sanizi from the pocket of his white waistcoat, thrust them on his hybrid nose with a savage, chopping motion, and read in a voice crackling with indignation, Dr. Frank Butterbough, The Beeches, Harrisonville, New Jersey. Dear Dr. Butterbough, the tombstone you ordered for your lot in Rosedale Cemetery has been prepared in accordance with your directions and is now ready for delivery. We shall be obliged if you will indicate when you will meet our representative at the cemetery and direct where you wish the monument placed. In accordance with your order, the stone has been inscribed Dr. Francis Butterbough, August 23, 1852, October 18, 1926, K.V.R.A.M.D.O. from Very Truly Yours, L. Grass Monument Works. Well, I began, but he shouted me down. Well, the devil. He rasped. It isn't well. I got that note in today's afternoon delivery and came into town hot foot to give the L. Grass people boiling hell for writing me such balderdash. Found they'd shut up shop for the day, so got John L. Grass on the phone at his house, and made the wire sizzle with the dressing down I gave him, and he had the brass-bound, copper-riveted gall to tell me he'd acted on my orders. My orders, you understand? Claimed to have my written authority for preparing a monument for my family plot, and he didn't. I cut in incredulously. You mean this letter is the first inkling you've had of a tombstone? Sulfur and brimstone, yes. The professor yelled. You think I wouldn't have remembered if I'd ordered a headstone for my own grave? That's what it amounts to, for my name's on the thing. And what the triple horn devil would I have had today's date cut on it for? Today's October 18th, in case you've forgotten it. And why in blazing doofus should I have anything as silly as K.V.R.A.M.D.O. from on my tombstone, even if I had to rush a bolt to the head and order the damn thing? Wait a moment, Professor, I asked. I'm a little rusty on my Latin. K.V.R.A.M.D.O. from, let's see, that means it means beware the wrath of the gods, if that is what you're after, he shot back, but that's of no importance. What I'd like to know is who the devil dared order a tombstone in my name. Pardon his M.O.I., Misher, perhaps it is that someone makes Lamov ass plays entry, how do you say it? The practical joke? Upon you. Jules de Grandin, very debonair in faultless dinner clothes, a white gardenia in his lapel, and a slender ebony walking stick in his hand, stood smiling at us from the study doorway. Trowbridge, mon cher, he'd earned to me, I did let myself in without knocking, in order to save the excellent Nora the trouble of opening the door, and I could not well escape overhearing this gentleman's extraordinary statement. Will you not tell me more, Misher? He regarded the professor with his round, childishly wide, blue eyes. More, more? Professor Butterbell barked. That's all there isn't any more. Some fool with a perverted sense of humor has forged my name to an order for a tombstone. By Set and Araman, I'll be hanged if the L. Grass people get a red-headed cent out of me for it. Let him find out who ordered it, and charge it to him. Pardon, Misher, I did hear you refer to the malignant deities of Egypt and Persia, is it that you? Oh, excuse me, I broke in, coming to a tardy recognition of my social obligations. Professor Butterbough, this is Dr. Jules de Grandin, of the University of Paris. Dr. de Grandin, this is Professor Frank Butterbough, who headed? Parbleu, yes. De Grandin interrupted, crossing the room hurriedly and seizing Butterbaugh's hand in both of his. No need for further introductions, friend Trowbridge. Who has not heard of that peerless savant, that archaeologist second only to the great Bouzard? The very great honor is entirely mine, monsieur. Professor Butterbaugh grinned a trifle sheepishly at the Frenchman's enthusiastic greeting, fidgeted with the Monument Company's letter and his glasses a moment, then reached for his hat and gloves. Must be moving, he ejaculated in his queer, disjointed way. Got to get home before Alice gives me double-jointed fits. Keepin' dinner waitin', do you know? Glad to have met you, he held out his hand almost diffidently today, Grandin, mighty glad. Hope you and Trowbridge can come over tomorrow. Got an unusual sort of mummy I'm figuring on starting to unwrap tonight. Like to have you medics there when I expose the body. De Grandin assented, helping himself to a cigarette. This mummy, then, it is different? You bet it is, Butterbaugh assured him colloquially. Don't believe there's another like it in the country. I've only seen one other of the kind, the one supposed to be Ronifer, in the British Museum, do you know? It has no funerary statue, just linen and bitumen molded to conform to the body's contours. Had the devil's own time getting it out of Egypt, too. Arabs went on strike half a dozen times, while we were digging. Egyptian government tried to collar the body, and, to top the whole business, a gang of swell-headed young cops sent me a batch of black hand letters, threatening all sorts of penalties, unless I returned the thing to its tomb. Hut, catch me giving up a relic literally worth its weight in gold to a crew of half-baked Johnnies, like that. But, Monsieur le Professor, De Grandin urged, his diminutive blonde mustache bristling with excitement, this letter, this tombstone order, it may have some relation. Not a chance. Butterbaugh scuffed. Egypt's halfway, round the world from here, and I've no more chance of running foul o' those chaps in this town than I have of being bitten by a crocodile. But his lips tightened stubbornly, and a faint flush deepened the suntanned hue of his face. But if all the Egyptian secret societies from Giza to Beni Hasan were camped on my front lawn, I start unwrapping that mummy tonight. Yes, by jingo, and finish the job, too, no matter how much they held. He glowered at us a moment, as though he expected us to forbid him, jammed his knockabout hat over his ears, slapped his thigh pugnaciously with his motoring gloves, and strode from the study, his back cast stiffly straight, as though a ramrod had been thrust down the collar of his Norfolk jacket. Something terrible has happened. Eh, what's that? I muttered stupidly into the transmitter of my bedside telephone, still too immersed in sleep to understand the import of the message coming over the wire. This is Alice Butterbaugh, Dr. Trowbridge, the fluttering voice repeated. Alice Butterbaugh, Professor Butterbaugh's niece. Something dreadful has happened. Uncle Frank's dead. Dead? I echoed, swinging my feet to the floor. Why, he was over to my house this evening, and... Yes, I know, she interrupted. He told me he stopped to show you that mysterious letter he got from the Algrass Company. He was well enough then, doctor, but I think he was murdered. Can you come right over? Of course, I promised, hanging up the receiver and hustling into my clothes. De Grandin, I called, opening his door on my way to the bathroom to wash the lingering sleep from my eyes with a dash of cold water. De Grandin, Professor Butterbaugh is dead, murdered, his niece thinks. Milton ears. The Frenchman was out of his bed, like a jack-in-the-box popping from its case. The half of one little minute, friend Trowbridge's silk pajamas were torn from his slender white body, and he struggled furiously into a white crepe union suit to you, but wait until I have applied the water to my face, the brush to my hair, and the wax to my mustache in Omuncochon. Where's that wax? He had drawn on socks, trousers, and boots, as he talked, and was already before the washstand, a bath sponge dripping with cold water, in one hand, a face towel in the other. Fly, my friend, hasten to the telephone, and advise the good Sergeant Costello what has occurred, he admonished. I would that he meets us at the professor's house. Pardieu, if some scoundrel has taken the life of that so great scholar, I, Jules de Grandin, will track him down and deliver him to justice, yes, though he takes refuge beneath the throne of Satan himself. 10 minutes later we were riding furiously toward a sinking moon over the smooth macadam road which led to the beaches. Her pretty yellow hair in attractive disorder, An orchid negligee drawn over her filmy night dress, and French-heeled satin mules of the same color on her little white feet, Alice Butterbaum met us in the wide reception hall of the Beeches, a very much frightened and entirely inarticulate butler at her elbow. "Oh, Dr. Trowbridge," she sobbed, seizing my arm in both her small hands, "I'm so glad you got here." She started back, folding the negligee across her diaphanous nightrobe as she became aware of de Grandin's presence. "This is Dr. Jules de Grandin, my dear," I introduced. "He is a member of the faculty of the University of Paris and has been stopping with me for a while. He will be of great assistance in case it develops your uncle met with foul play. How do you do, Dr. de Grandin?" Alice acknowledged, extending her hand. "I am sure you will be able to help us in our trouble." "Mademoiselle," de Grandin bowed his sleek blonde head, as he pressed his lips to her fingers, "command as M-O-I-J-S-U-I-S-P-R-E-T. And now his air of gallantry fell from him like a cloak, as he straightened his shoulders. "Will you be good enough to take us to the scene and tell us all?" "I gone to bed," the girl began, as she led the way toward her uncle's library. Uncle Frank was terribly excited all afternoon, after he received that letter, and when he came back from Harrisonville he was still boiling inwardly. I could hardly get him to eat any dinner. Just as soon as dinner was over he went to the library, where he has been keeping the latest addition to his collection of mummies, and told me he was going to begin unpacking it. I went to bed about 11:30 and called goodnight to him through the library door as I passed. I went to sleep almost immediately, but something I don't know what, but I'm sure it was not a noise of any kind, woke me up a few minutes after 2. I lay there trying to get back to sleep until nearly 3, then decided to go to the bathroom for a bromide tablet. As I walked down the passage I noticed a light shining out of the library door into the lower hall, so I knew the door must be open. Uncle never left the door unclosed when he was working, for he hated to have the servants looking at him, and they would stand in the passage and stare if they thought he'd doing anything with his mummies. It seemed to fascinate them. Knowing Uncle's habits, I thought he had gone to bed without shutting off the light, and went down to turn it out. When I got here I found she paused beside the door with averted eyes, and motioned toward the room beyond. Professor Butterbaum lay on his back, staring with sightless, dead eyes at the glowing globes of the electric chandelier, his body straight and stiff, legs extended, arms laying at his sides, as though he had fallen backward from an upright position, and remained immovable since his fall. Despite the post-mortem flaccidity of his features, his countenance retained something of the expression it must have worn when death touched him, and, gazing at his face, it seemed to me he looked more startled than frightened or angry. Nowhere was there evidence of any sort of struggle, not so much as a paper was disturbed on the big, flat-topped desk beside which the dead scientist lay, and the only witness testifying to tragedy was the still, inert remnant of what had been one of the world's foremost Egyptologists some 3 or 4 hours before. "Beg pardon, Miss Alice," the pale-faced manservant, trousers and coat pulled over his night clothes, tiptoed toward the professor's niece, "there's a gentleman outside, a Sergeant Costello, from the police department." "The police?" The girl's pallid face went paler still. "W.H., what are the police doing here? Who told them?"
I don't know, miss," the serving man stammered. "I did notify the good sergeant, mademoiselle," de Grandin announced, looking up from beside the professor's body. "Send him to me at once, immediately, right away," he ordered the butler, and walked quickly to the door to greet the burly, red-headed Irishman. "Hola, my friend," he called as the detective crossed the hall, "we have here a wicked business to investigate. Some miscreant has struck down your famous fellow townsman, from the back, and back, is it?" Costello replied, looking meditatively at Butterbaum's supine form. "And how you make that out, Dr. de Grandin? Seems to me there's no marks of violence on body at all, and poor gentleman died from natural causes. Apoplexy, it was, belike. He was a peppery-tempered old devil, God rest his soul." "Apoplexy, yes," de Grandin agreed with a mirthless smile, "since apoplexy is only a general name for the condition more definitely called cerebral hemorrhage. Behold the cause of this apoplexy, my friend." Stooping, he raised the professor's head, pointing to the occipital region. Against the dead man's smoothly brushed iron gray hair lay a stain of blood, scarcely larger than a 25-cent piece, and so meager in its moisture that the Turkish rug on which the head had rested showed hardly any discoloration. Parting the hair, de Grandin showed a small, smooth-edged wound about the caliber of an ordinary lead pencil, a bit of whitish substance swelling up to the very edge of the opening, and all, but stopping any blood flow from inside the head. Gun? Costello bent to examine the puncture. I do not think so, the Frenchman replied. Had a shot been fired from a pistol at close range, or a rifle from a distance, the bullet would probably have gone out of the head, yet there is only one wound here. Had a firearm of low power, unable to drive the missile through the head, been used, the bone would have shattered at the point of entrance, yet here we have a clean-cut wound. No, my friend, this injury is the result of some hand weapon. Besides, Mademoiselle Butterbough was in the house, as were also the servants, yet none recalls having heard a shot fired. Mademoiselle, he rose from his examination of the body, you did mention that your uncle was unwrapping a certain mummy tonight. This mummy, where is it, if you please? I don't know, the girl faltered. I thought it was in here, but... But it is not, de Grandin supplied dryly. Come, Miss Amos, let us search for this missing cadaver. There are times when the dead can tell us more than the living. We crossed the library, passed between a pair of heavy brocade curtains, and entered a smaller room walled with smooth plaster, its only furniture being a series of glass cases containing small specimens of Egyptian, and a rank of upright mummy cases standing straight and sentinel-like against the farther wall. Holy Mither! Costello exclaimed, his native brogue cutting through his acquired American accent, as he pointed one hand toward one of T.H. mummy cases, signing himself piously with the cross with the other. The center figure in the rank of mummies stood in a case somewhat taller than its fellows, and, unlike the others, was not hidden from view by a coffinlet, for the cover from its case had fallen to the floor, disclosing the mummy to our gaze. The body had been almost entirely denuded of its bandages, the face, arms, and lower portion of the legs having been freed, so that, had it been a living man instead of a corpse, neither walking nor the use of the arms would have been impeded by the linen bands which remained in place. This much I saw at a glance, but the cause of Costello's outcry was not plain until I had looked a second time. Then I added my amazed gasp to the big Irishman's exclamation, for in the right hand of the dead thing was firmly grasped a rod of polished wood tipped by a hawk's head executed in metal, the bird's beak being some 3 inches in length, curved and sharp as the hooked needles used by upholsterers to sew heavy fabrics. Upon the metal point of the beak was a faintly perceptible smear of blood, and a drop of the grisly liquid had fallen to the floor, making a tiny, dark red stain at the mummy's desiccated feet. And on the mummy's face, drawn by the embalming process into a sort of sardonic grin, was another reddish smear, as though the dead thing had bent its lips to the wound inflicted by the instrument clutched in its dead hand. Pardieu, friend Trowbridge, I think we need look no farther for the weapon which took Monsieur Butterbough's life, de Grandin commented, twisting the end of his mustache with a nervous gesture. W.U.Z. This Professor W.U.Z. work in, on? Costello demanded, turning to the butler, who had followed us to the door of the specimen room. Oh, my G.A.W.D. The servant exclaimed with a shudder. As he beheld the armed and sneering cadaver standing in its case, one mummified foot slightly advanced, as though the thing were about to step into the room in search of fresh victims. Never mind Ballin, Costello ordered, answer me question. W.U.Z. This mummy Professor Butterbough W.U.Z. unwrapping, when it happened to him? I don't know, sir, the servant quavered. I never saw the thing before, and, well, me G.A.W.D., I never want to see it again. But I think it must be the one Dr. Butterbough had in mind, for there are 5 mummies there now, and this morning, when I came in to open the blinds, there were only 4 standing against the walls, and one was laying on the floor over by the door. Humph, guess this is one, then, Costello replied. Go outside there and get other servants. Tell them I want to question them, and don't tell what you've seen here. De Grandin walked quickly to the grinning mummy and examined the pointed instrument in his hand minutely. Tresbian, he murmured to himself, giving the relic room a final appraising glance. Aren't you going to look into those other mummy cases? I asked, as he turned to leave. Not I, he denied. Let Sergeant Costello busy himself with them. Me, I have other matters of more importance to attend to. Come, let us examine the servants. The cook, a large and very frightened negress, a diminutive and likewise badly frightened colored boy who tended the garden and acted as chauffeur to white mates, both safely past the heyday of youth, and the butler composed the domestic staff of the Beaches. Costello marshaled them in line, and began a series of searching questions, but de Grandin, after a single look at the crowd, approached the sergeant and excused himself, saying we would talk the matter over the following morning. Thank you, Sir, Costello acknowledged. I take it kindly of ye to see that I got first look in on this case before any of newspaper boys had a chance to spoil it. I'll be coming over to your house tomorrow and we'll go over all evidence together, so we will. Excellent, de Grandin agreed. Good night, Sergeant. I am not sure, but I think we shall soon have these murderers beneath the lock and key of your so efficiently strong jail. Murderers? Costello echoed. They think they're W.U.Z. more than one of them, then, S.R. Parbleu, yes, I know it, de Grandin responded. Good night, mon vieux. Well, Dr. de Grandin, Sergeant Costello announced, as he entered my office the following afternoon, we've got about as far as we can with case. Ah, de Grandin smiled pleasantly, as he pushed a box of cigars across the table. And what have you discovered, cher sergeant? Well, Sir, the Irishman grinned deprecatingly, I can't rightly say we've found out much of anything, precisely. Instance, we've found that somebody forged Professor Butterball's signature to letter to L. Grass Monument Works. We put it under a lens at headquarters today, and you can't see where name's been traced as plain as daylight. Yes, de Grandin encouraged. And have you any theory as to who forged that letter, or who killed the professor? No, Sir, we haven't, the detective confessed. Between you and me, Sir, that Miss Alice may know more about business than she lets on. I wouldn't say she W.U.Z. exactly glad to see me, when I come last night, and well, she hasn't been any too helpful. This morning, when I W.U.Z. button servants through their paces again to see if there W.U.Z. any discrepancies between stories they told last night and what they might be saying this time, she ups and says she, officer, she says, you've been over all that before, she says, and I'll not have my servants humiliated, she says, by having you ask him every few hours which one of them killed me uncle. So I ups and says, all right, miss, I don't suppose you have any suspicions concerning who killed him? And she says, certainly not. Just like that. And that W.U.Z. that, Sir. Now, don't you be getting me wrong, Dr. de Grandin and Dr. Trowbridge. Miss Butterbough is a high-toned lady, and all that, and I'm not making any wise cracks about her being guilty, or even having guilty knowledge, but... The sharp staccato of my office phone cut his statement in half. Hello? I called tentatively, as I lifted the receiver. Sergeant Costello, I want to speak to Sergeant Costello, an excited voice demanded. This is Schultz speaking. All right, I replied, passing the instrument to the sergeant. Hello? Costello growled, yes, Schultz, this is Costello, what's what? When? Oh, it did it? Yes, you bet your sweet life I'll be right over, and you'd best get busy, and cook up a sweet young alibi by time I get there, too, young felly me lad. Gentlemen, he turned a blank face to us, that W.U.Z. Schultz, uniformed man I'd left on duty at Beaches. He tells me that mummy one with little pickaxe in its hand has disappeared from house right before his eyes. T.O.U.S. Ladymans. De Grandin cried, springing from his chair. I expected this. Come, my friends, let us hasten, let us speed, let us fly. Parbleu, but the trail may not yet have grown cold. I was making my rounds, as you told me, sir, Patrolman Schultz explained to Sergeant Costello. I'd been through the house and looked in on that queer-looking mummy in the little room, and seen everything was in order. Then I went out to the garage. Julius, the chauffeur, was telling me that he was going to quit his job as soon as the police investigation was done, 'cause he wouldn't dare live here after what's happened, and I was wondering if he was suffering from a guilty conscience, or what, so I stopped to talk to him, and see what he'd say. I couldn't have been outside more than 15 minutes, all told, and I came right back in the house, but that mummy was clean gone when I got back. Oh, it wuz it? Costello answered sarcastically. I don't suppose you heard it hollering for help, while it wuz bein' kidnapped, or anything like that while you wuz out Sherlock Holmes and th apostrophe chauffeur, did you? Oh, course not. You wuz too busy, playin' old King Brady, to pay attention to your regular duties. Well, now, young felly, let me tell you something. We'll find that missing mummy, and we'll find him toot sweet, as Dr. de Grandin would say, or badge number 687 will be turned in at headquarters tonight, er get me? He turned on his heel and walked toward the house, leaving the crestfallen young patrolman staring helplessly after him. We were about to follow him, when the rattle of a Ford delivery wagon on the gravel driveway drew our attention. A young man in white apron and jacket jumped from the machine and approached the service porch, a basket of groceries on his arm. Sorry to keep your order waiting, he told the cook, as he handed her the hamper and a duplicate sales slip for her signature, but I like to got kilt coming up th apostrophe road about 20 minutes ago. I was driving out th apostrophe Pike's low and easy when a big touring car shot oil th apostrophe lane and crowded me into the ditch. If I hadn't had my foot on th apostrophe gas and been able to skedaddle low th apostrophe way before they ran me down, I'd most likely have been killed, and maybe th apostrophe cake eater and sheep than th apostrophe other car as well. Where was it you had the so close escape? De Grandin asked, approaching the youth with an ingratiating smile. Down th apostrophe road to peace, the other replied, nothing loath to dilate on his adventure. Do you know, there's a lane that skirts th apostrophe edge of Professor Butterbaugh's place and runs out to th apostrophe pike, near Twin Pines. There's a tall hedge growing on each side of th apostrophe lane, where it comes out on th apostrophe pike, and these folks must have been throwing a neckin' party or something up there, for they was running in low kindo sneakin' along not makin' a bit o' noise, till they was within a few feet of th apostrophe main road, then they stepped on her for fair. And come out into th apostrophe highway running, like a skirt dawg. Indeed. De Grandin raised sympathetic eyebrows. And did you notice the people in this car? They should be arrested for such actions. I'll say I noticed 'em. The grocery boy answered with an emphatic nod. The sheep who was driving was one of them lounge lizards with patent leather hair, and th apostrophe Jane was little and dark, with big eyes and a sort of sneery look. She was holding something in her lap, looked like it might have been another girl's head, or something. Anyways, it was all covered up with cloth. And they didn't even excuse themselves for crowding me into the ditch, just went on down th apostrophe road toward Morristown, like grease lightning. De Grandin's little mustache was twitching with eagerness, like the whiskers of a tomcat before a rat hole, but his voice was casual, as he asked, and did you notice the number of this car which so nearly wrecked you, mon petit? What's that? The other replied suspiciously. Did you make note of their license plate? You betcha, the lad produced a brown paperback notebook, obviously intended for emergency orders, from his patrons, and thumbed through its dog-eared leaves. Yep, here it is, Y-453-677-5344. New Jersey plate. Ah, my excellent one, my incomparable little cabbage. De Grandin restrained himself from kissing the white-aproned youth with the utmost difficulty. My Napoleon among epic ears, behold, I shall make restitution for the fright these miscreants have given you. From his trousers pocket he produced a billfold and extracted a $5 note, which he pressed into the delivery boy's hand. Take it, my wise one, he urged, quite unnecessarily take it, and buy a plaything for one of your numerous sweethearts. Pardieu, such a well-favored youth must play the devil with the maiden's hearts, S.C.E. Pock. He thrust a playful finger into the astonished youngster's ribs. Sure, the other responded, pocketing the bill, and backing away rather hastily. Sure, I got a Jane, if think I'm a dead one? N-O-M-N-C-O-Q, quite otherwise. You do possess the eye of Argus, and the sagacity of Solon, mon brave de Grandin assured him, then, to me, come, Trowbridge, my friend. Let us fly with all celerity to the lane of which this so charming urchin has told us. Let us discover what we can see. We ran across the white lawn to the tall, rank-growing privet hedge which marked the margin of the Butterbough place, slipped through the shrubbery, and began walking slowly down the unpaved roadway. "Nom-de-Dieu, we have it!" the Frenchman exclaimed, pointing dramatically to the soft sand at our feet. "Behold, friend Trowbridge, where a car, even as described by the youthful Solomon, has been driven up this path and turned about at this point. Also, observe how two pairs of feet, one shod in white-soled shoes, the other in slippers with the French heels, have walked from that car to the hedge, and here, do you not see it? Back again, and with wider steps, and deeper impressions in the earth? Parbleu, my friend, our noses are to the earth. Anon we shall bring the quarry into view." Slipping through the hedge, he ran at top speed to the house, entered one of the open French windows, and called excitedly for Costello. "Quick, mon vieux," he urged when the sergeant came in answer to his repeated hails, "we must delay the expedition. I would that you broadcast by telephone an alarm to all towns and villages, in the direction of Morristown, to have a touring car bearing the New Jersey license way, 4536775344 stopped at all costs. It must be delayed, it must be held, it must be impeded until I arrive." Costello regarded him in open-mouthed wonder, but proceeded to telephone headquarters to post a general lookout for the wanted car. "And now, Dr. de Grandin, Essor," he whispered, "if you'd be good enough to lend me a bit of a hand in questioning these here servants, I believe we could get something o'ta them. They're beginning to weaken." "Ah, bah," de Grandin replied. "Waste not your breath on these innocent ones, my friend. We shall be within reaching distance of these criminals when that car has been apprehended." In truth, they did fit the description to a perfection. "Description?" echoed the sergeant. "What description? Has someone been spilling th' beans to you, Essor?" "Ah, yes, someone has talked to me." In silence, de Grandin replied. "There were at least two people in the library with Professor Butterbough when he was killed, and one of them, at least, had straight hair, smoothed down with some sort of unguent hair, moreover, which had been cut about 2 weeks ago. This person must have been somewhat shorter than the professor, and must have stood immediately before him when he was struck down from behind." Sergeant Costello looked at him a moment in speechless wonder, then an ingratiating grin spread over his face. He rose, facing de Grandin with a praised forefinger, like an adult telling a fable to a dubious youngster. "And th' wolf said to Little Red Riding Hood, 'Where are ye going, me pretty child?'" he interrupted. "I've seen ye do a lot o' things which I'd have thought wuz magic if I hadn't seen, and with me own two eyes, Dr. de Grandin," he confessed, "but when ye go into a trance, like that an begin fortune telling about how many people wuz present 20th professor was killed, and how long it had been since one of em had his hair cut, I'm having to remind ye that it's been many a year since I believed in fairy tales, Essor." "Fairy tales, do you say?" de Grandin returned good-naturedly. "Parbleu, my friend, do not you know that the most improbable of the tales of the fairies is sober logic itself beside the seemingly impossible miracles which science performs each day? Nom-porc, 100 years ago men were hanged as wizards for knowing not one-tenth as much as Jules de Grandin has forgotten these 20 years. Amuse yourself, cher sergeant. Question the servants to your heart's content, but be ready to accompany me the minute that missing car is reported caught, I do entreat you. It's th' Templeton Police Department speaking, Dr. de Grandin," Costello announced some 3/4 hour later, as he looked up from the telephone. "Will ye be talking to him, Essor?" "Sure, I haven't th' ghost of an idea what it is you're wanting with th' young lad and lady that wuz riding in th' car you wanted held up." "Allo, allo?" de Grandin barked into the telephone, as he snatched the receiver from the sergeant's hand. "This is Jules de Grandin speaking, Monsieur le Chef. You have the occupants of that car in custody. Bien, you do delight me. Charge." "Parbleu, I had forgotten that you require a specific charge on which to hold persons in custody in this country. Tell me, Mr., you have searched that car, no? A pause, during which he drummed nervously on the telephone table with the tips of his slender white fingers, then, so. Trasbian, I and Sergeant Costello, of the Harrisonville Police, come on the wings of the wind to relieve you of your prisoners' responsibility. But of course, hold them, my friend. Place them under the double lock, with gendarmes at door and window, and I shall indubitably indemnify you against all responsibility. Only, I beseech you, hold them in safety until we arrive. He turned to us, his small blue eyes sparkling with excitement. Come, my friends, come away, let us make haste to that commandant of police at Templeton. He has there the birds for our cage. We jumped into my waiting car and turned toward Templeton, Costello sitting in the tonneau, a black cigar at a rakish angle in his mouth, an expression of doubt on his face, de Grandin beside me, drumming on the leather upholstery of the seat, and humming excitedly to himself. What's it all about, de Grandin? I asked, as, responding to his urging, I pressed my foot on the accelerator and drove the machine several miles beyond the legal speed. Mean, he answered, turning a twitching face and dancing eyes on me. Possess yourself in patience, my friend. Restrain your curiosity for only a few little minutes. Curb your inquisitiveness only so long as it takes this abominably slow motor to convey us to that police chief at Templeton. Then parbleu. You shall know. Yes, parlabarbi de profit, you, and the good Costello, too, shall know all. He threw back his head and burst into a snatch of marching song, ellerit, est out el mau qlsaid fair, Madeline. We've got him locked in there, the Templeton police chief told us when I brought my panting motor to a halt before the little town's near Greystone Municipal Building. Far as I can see, there's no charge you can hold him on, legally, and there's apt to be some trouble over this business. Sure, we found a mummy in the car in response to De Grandin's eager question, but I don't know any law against transporting a mummy through the streets. Go in and talk to him if you want to, but make it snappy. And remember, if there's any comeback about a false arrest or anything like that, it's strictly your funeral. Parbleu, Monsieur le Chef, De Grandin replied with a smile, it is like to be a double funeral. With the state of New Jersey officiating, unless Jules de Grandin is more mistaken than he thinks he is. Two people, a young man of 25 or 26, and a young woman of about the same age, sat on the polished oak benches of the municipal council room which the Templeton police chief had turned into an improvised dungeon for their detention. The man was dressed with that precise attention to detail which characterizes the better class foreigner, while the woman's modish traveling costume was more reminiscent of the Rue de la Paix than of the dressmakers of America. Both were dark-skinned with the clear olive complexion of the South, black-eyed, and patrician of feature. And despite their air of hauteur, they were plainly ill at ease. This is an outrage. The man burst forth in a perfectly accentless voice which proclaimed more plainly than faulty speech that the words he used were not of his mother tongue. This is an outrage, sir. What right have you to hold us here against our will? De Grandin fixed him with a level stare, rigid and uncompromising as a pointed bayonet. And the murder of a respected citizen of this country, Monsieur, he asked, is that, perhaps, not also an outrage? What do you mean? The man began, but the Frenchman cut him off curtly. You and your companion did enter the house of Professor Francis Butterbaugh last night, or more definitely, early this morning, he replied, and one of you did engage him in conversation, while the other took the scepter of Isis from the wrappings of the mummy, and struck him with it, from behind. Do not lie to me, my Egyptian friend, your tongue may be false, Kardu, are you not a nation of liars? But the hairs of your head tell the truth. Parbleu, you did not think that your victim would throw out his arm at the moment you murdered him, and seize evidence which would put the rope of justice about your necks? You did not apprehend that I, Jules de Grandin, would be at hand to deliver you to the public executioner, Hein? The prisoners stared at him in astonished silence. Then, you have no proof that we were near Butterbaugh's house last night, the man answered, moving a step toward a sheeted object which lay on one of the council benches. De Grandin smiled unpleasantly. No proof, do you say? he returned. Pardieu, I have all the proof needed to put you both to a shameful death. I have Trowbridge, Costello, stop him. He flung himself at the prisoner, who had rounded the end of the bench, and reached suddenly toward the thing, under the sheet, drawing forth a tiny, wriggling object, and pressed it quickly to his wrist. Too late, the man observed, holding out his hand to the woman beside him and sinking to the bench beside the sheeted object. Dr. Jules de Grandin is too late. The young woman hesitated the fraction of a second as her fingers met those of her companion, then, with widening eyes, thrust her hand into the low-cut bosom of her dress, drew herself up very straight, and, as a slight shiver ran through her frame, dropped to the bench beside the man. Dieu et le diable. De Grandin swore furiously. You have cheated me. I back, friend Trowbridge, back, sergeant, there is death on the floor. He cannoned into me, sending me stumbling toward the row of council seats, poised himself on tiptoe, and leaped lithely into the air, coming down with both feet close together, grinding his heels savagely on the floor. Beneath the edge of his boot sole I made out the sharp-pointed, thrashing end of some small, cylindrical object. 5,000 years of life, in death, and now eternal death, beneath the feet of Jules de Grandin. He announced, stepping back, and revealing a short, black thing, scarcely thicker through its crushed body, in an angleworm, and no longer than a man's hand. What is it, Essor? Costello queried, looking at the still writhing thing disclosed by the Frenchman's lifted foot. I blame you not for failing to recognize him, cher sergeant, the other replied, the good street Patrick did drive him and all his family from your native land some 1,500 years ago. To me he said, friend Trowbridge, before you lies what remains of such a snake as did kill Cleopatra, no less. To discourage robbers from the graves of their great ones, I have heard, the Egyptians did sometimes secrete the comatose bodies of serpents among the wrappings of their mummies. I have often heard such tales, but never before have I seen evidence of their truth. Like the toad and the frog, who are found within fossil rocks, the snake has the ability to live indefinitely in suspended animation. When these miscreants did expose this viper to the air, he was revived, and I make no doubt they allowed him to live against just such a contingency as this. Do you desire more proof? Is not their double suicide a confession sufficient of guilt? He turned questioning eyes from Costello to me, then glared at the prisoners shivering on the bench beside the sheeted object. What's this? Costello demanded, striding to the seat, where the man and woman sat, and snatching the sheet from the form beside them. Holy Street Judas, 'tis T.H., grinning mummy itself. He exclaimed, as he bared the sardonically smiling features of the thing we had seen in Professor Butterbaugh's relic room the night of his murder. But of course, de Grandin replied, what else? Did I not surmise and much when that young grocery man told us of the fleeing couple, in the motor car? And did I not have you send out the alarm for the detention of that same car? And did I not particularly question the police chief of this city concerning the presence of a mummy in the motor, when he did inform me that he had apprehended our fugitives? Most assuredly. Me, I am Jules de Grandin. I do not make mistakes. He directed a quizzical gaze at the prisoners. Your time grows short, he stated. Will you confess now, or must I assure you that I shall cut your hearts from out your dead bodies, and feed them to carrion crows? Remember, I am a medical man, and my request that I be allowed to perform an autopsy on you will unquestionably be honored. You will confess, or he waved an eloquent hand, the gesture expressing unpleasant possibilities. The man twisted his thin lips in a mirthless grin. You may as well know, he replied, but we must be assured our ashes will be taken to Egypt for burial, before I tell you anything. The Frenchman raised his hand. You have my assurance of that if you tell all, and my equal assurance that you shall be dissected as subjects of anatomical study, if you do not, he promised. Come, begin. Time presses and there is much to tell. Make haste. It does not matter who we are, you can find our names and residences from our papers, the prisoner began. As to what we are, you have perhaps heard of the movement to revive the secret worship of the old gods of Egypt among those who trace their ancestry to the ancient rulers of the earth? De Grandin nodded shortly. We are members of that movement, the man continued. We Copts possess the blood of Ramses, mighty ruler of the world of Tut on Kamen and Dronifer. Our race was old and glorious when Babylon was a swamp. and you Franks were only naked savages. Pagan Greek and pagan Roman, Christian Frank, and Muslim Arab all have swarmed in upon us, forcing their religions down our throats at the sword's point, but our hearts have remained constant to the gods we worshipped in the days of our greatness. For centuries a faithful few have done honor to Osiris and Isis, to Horus and Nut and Anubis, and mighty ram-headed Ra, father of gods, and fashioner of men, but only in recent years, with the weakening of the Muslims' hated power, have we dared extend our organization. Today we have a complete hierarchy. I am a vowed servant of Osiris, my sister here is a dedicated priestess of Isis. That the barbarians of Europe and America should delve among the tombs of our illustrious dead, and drag their sacred relics forth for fools to gape at has long been intolerable to us as the violation of the tombs of Napoleon or Washington would be to French or Americans, but for years we have been forced to suffer these insults in silence. Before this robber, Butterbow, desecrated the tomb of Ankh-Mahemen, he motioned toward the uncovered, grinning mummy on the bench beside him. Our priesthood had passed sentence of death on all who'd have spoiled our burying places in future. The Englishman, Carnarvon, died by our orders. Other tomb robbers met their just deserts at our hands. Now you know why Butterbow was executed. We gave the thieving savage fair warning of our intent before he took the stolen body out of Egypt. But the English police may set burn them. Prevented our carrying out our sentence there, so we followed him to America. We had obtained a specimen of his signature in Cairo. It was easy to forge his name to the order for his tombstone. Last night my sister and I waited outside his house until his servants had gone to bed. We watched the thief gloating over the body of our sacred dead, saw him unwind the sacerdotal wrappings from it, and while he was still at his ghoulish work we entered an open window, and read him the death sentence pronounced on him by the council of our priests. The grave robber ordered us from his house, threatened us with arrest, and would have assaulted me, but my sister, who stood behind him, struck him dead with a single blow of the holy scepter of Isis which he had taken from the cerements of the body outraged by his profane hands. We restored the body of Ankh-Mahemen to its case, and were about to take it to our car, that we might carry it back to its tomb in Egypt, when we heard someone moving about upstairs, and had to make our escape. We put the scepter of Isis in the hand of our ancestor, for it was to avenge his desecrated tomb, that we put Butterbow to death. A smear of the robber's blood was on my sister's hand, and she wiped it off on Ankh-Mahemen's lips. It was poetic justice. Our outraged countrymen drank the blood of his ravisher. Today we returned, and took our dead from the polluting atmosphere of Butterbow's house, while your stupid police looked on, and saw nothing. How you discovered us we do not know, but may the lightnings of Osiris blast you, may Apepi, the serpent, crush your bones, and the pestilence of Typhon wither your flesh. May. A convulsive shudder ran through him, he half rose from the bench, then slid forward limply, his hands clutching futilely at the withered hands of the mummy which grinned sardonically into his face. I glanced hastily toward the girl, who had sat silent during her brother's narrative. Her jaw had dropped, her head sagged forward on her breast, and her eyes stared straight before her with the inane, fixed stare of the newly dead. De Grandin studied the three bodies before us a long moment, then turned to Costello. You will make what report is necessary, my friend? He asked. Sure, I will, Esor, the detective assented, and I got to hand it to you for cleaning up Mystery so neat, too. But, begging your pardon, how you intend making good on your promise to ship these here dead corpses back home? De Grandin smiled quickly. Did you not hear him demand my promise to ship his ashes to Egypt? He asked. When the official formalities are concluded, we shall have them cremated. Excuse me for bothering you, Dr. Jules De Grandin, Costello apologized, as we concluded dinner at my house that evening, but I ain't etiquetted like you and Dr. Trowbridge here, and there's a lot of things, that's plain as ABC. To you gentlemen, that don't seem to mean nothing at all to me. Would you mind telling me how you figured this here case out so easy? And his florid face went a shade redder. And excuse me for trying to get funny with you this afternoon, when you wuz telling DH apostrophe gang we must find head. Yes, De Grandin, arged, tell us, I'm as much in the dark as servant Costello. Glory be, the Irishman exclaimed fervently, then I'm not the only dumbbell in DH apostrophe party. De Grandin turned his quick, Elfish smiled on each of us in turn, then knocked the ashes from his cigar into his coffee cup. "All men have two eyes unless they have one," he began, "and all see the same things, but not all do know what it is that they see. When we did go to that Professor Butterbaugh's house, after he had been murdered, I did first observe the size, appearance, and location of the wound, whereof he died. Next I did look very carefully about to see what autograph his murderers had left. Believe me, my friends, all criminals leave their visiting cards, if only the police can read them. Trespn, I did find that in the professor's right hand were clutched 4 or 5 short, black hairs, straight, glossy hairs, with traces of pomade still upon them. Now, at the Faculty of Medicine Legal, to which I have the honor to belong, we have spent much time in the study of such things. We know, for example, that in case of sudden death, especially where there has been injury done the nervous system, the body undergoes an instantaneous rigidity, making the dead hand grasp and firmly hold any object within its reach. Thus we have found soldiers, shot on the field of battle, firmly holding their rifles, suicides clutching the pistols with which they have ended their lives, or, occasionally, drowned bodies grasping grass, weeds, or gravel. Also we have learned that fragments of clothing, hair, or other foreign substances clutched in a dead man's hand, unless they be from his own attire or person, indicate the presence of some other person at the instant of death, and hence point to murder rather than suicide. Again, we have paid much attention to the evidence borne by the location of wounds. Friend Trowbridge, he'd earned to me, will you be so good as to take up that spoon, stand behind me, and make as though you would dash out my brains with it. Wonderingly, I picked up a spoon, placed myself behind him, and struck him quickly, though lightly, on the head. "Bon, Trespn," he exclaimed. "Make careful note where your blow did fall, my friend. Now, Sergeant, will you do likewise?" Costello obeyed, and I could not repress a start of surprise. The blow struck by Costello came into contact with the Frenchman's sleek light hair less than an inch from where my spoon had struck. "You see," de Grandin grinned delightedly. "Almost always it is so. Wounds of the head from axes, hammers, and the like are almost invariably found on the left parietal area. If the assailant is in front, if he stands behind his victim, the injury will usually be found on the right side of the occiput, where both of you unconsciously struck me." "Very well. When I did examine Professor Butterbaugh's death wound, I knew he was struck down from behind." "Excellent, so far. But if he was killed from the back, how came those hairs grasped in his hand?" "He could not have reached behind to seize his murderer. The hairs would not have been so clutched had the murderer first confronted him, then rushed behind to strike the fatal blow, and that wound could not possibly have been given by one standing before him. Voila, there were two persons, at least, present when the professor died. The weapon used we found in the hand of that mummy which did grin, like the cats of Cheshire, and on his lips we found a smear of blood. That, coupled with the professor's experiences in Egypt, the so mysterious tombstone which he had not ordered, and which said, 'Beware the wrath of the gods,' and the fact that more robbery had been attempted, all convinced me it was a killing of revenge. Espo, I did examine those hairs under the microscope, while my good Trowbridge slept that night. Their color and texture excluded the possibility of their belonging to the professor, or to any of his servants. They could not have come from the mummy's head, for he was shaven padded, and the condition of their ends, which was slightly rounded, showed they had been cut by a barber some 2 weeks hence. I say to me, suppose some person have come from Egypt to kill this Professor Butterbaugh, suppose he have come on the sea some 3 or 4 weeks, suppose, again, he are a wealthy, fastidious man. What would be one of the first things he would do when he came to shore? I answer, parbleu, he would undoubtedly have his hair cut. Correct, I reply. And could he arrange to kill the professor and order a tombstone in 2 weeks? He could, I respond. Very well. I have argued so far with myself and decided we must look for two people, one of them, at least, with brunette hair which have been cut some 2 weeks ago. Both of them, probably, dark-skinned, because they are probably Egyptian, but not black, because the hairs say he belonged to a white man. Where shall we find these murderers in the nation of 100 million people of many different complexions? I do not know, but I shall try, I promise me, and then call you. and then we meet that so charming lad from the grocery shop who tells us of the couple in the speeding car, and of the young woman who holds some wrapped up thing in her lap. The mummy is missing, these people speed, there are wheel tracks and footprints of a most suspicious kind in the lane by the professor's house, French Robridge, and I have seen them, parbleu, why are not these two runaways the persons we seek? We did seek them, my friends, and we did find them, and though that ancient snake did cheat your executioner, we did exact their lives in payment for that of Professor Butterbough. He smiled contentedly, as he resumed his seat, and poured a thimbleful of glowing creme de menthe over the crushed ice in his liqueur glass. Justice, my friends, he pronounced, she is hard to evade. When she are accompanied by Jules de Grand and Grand de IEU, she are invincible. The end. This audio was brought to you by Yakitome. Voice of the Web. YAKITOME.com